Jane Butler. I'm one of the EBUK, soon to become EBUKI, project officers, and really excited to be bringing Ireland in. Anyone who wasn't at the AGM, I don't think it's actually been mentioned, that we are in the process of becoming Earthbuilding UK and Ireland, which is a really exciting development. And in Ireland, we need, I suppose, you know, a bit of help. We're much further behind than you are here. And so having Ireland officially in the group is going to really give us some teeth, I think, and really start interesting things happening. So I'm going to talk about the culture of earthbuilding in Ireland. I've been running workshops here all week. We built the cob wall outside with a great team of probably over 30 people during the week. So I haven't looked at the slideshow recently, and I might get a bit stuck. Hopefully I'll kind of get through it. But just in examples of, this is May glass, which I will talk about later, which was restored by the Heritage Council in Ireland back in 2001. And then this is my own home, which is a cob home, which we finished about 4.5 years ago. And it was kind of through that it was actually through discovering cob as a modern green material that I actually discovered we have a huge earth-built heritage in Ireland, which I was completely unaware of until I discovered this material. So just to kind of give a bit of a background, set the scene, this is an old map of Ireland, and Ireland in the olden days was not doing anything. Forested. So really people kind of approached Ireland from two different ways. So this is the southeast of the country, obviously, and so the Anglo-Saxons and the Normans kind of tended to move into Ireland from this direction. And then from the northwest, we have very, very strong links with Scotland, that there would have been traveling from Scotland down to the northwest of Ireland and coming into the country here. And I suppose almost kind of in microcultures or whatever, there would be this kind of divide between the southeast and the northwest, and it does crop up a bit as we go on. And because of that, it's kind of said, but I think Shirley Markley's going to talk after me, and she's going to talk about a lot of medieval earth bonded architecture, ignored, clay mortared stone architecture. But there kind of isn't, it's kind of said, or the current kind of knowledge is that there weren't really many earth buildings in Ireland. There would have been wattle and daub, but when you see the amount of forest that were in the country, it kind of makes sense that maybe we didn't massively build out of earth at the time. And then these two likely lads came along. So between the 16th and 17th century, is that right? We had first Henry VIII, who the Normans came into Ireland, and the Anglo-Normans, and they became, as we'd say, more Irish than the Irish. They kind of married, got on, everyone great. You know, the clans, the chieftains, that all still went on, and Henry decided enough is enough, and he was going to turn us into a proper kingdom. And then, you know, kind of before the end of the 1700s, Oliver Cromwell came along, and the end of the 1600s, Oliver Cromwell came along and finished the job. And while they were doing that, they basically deforested Ireland. You know, they were chasing down the wild men who were hiding in the woods. They were building their armadas. And basically, Ireland became very deforested. And from that point on, from the early 1700s, we do kind of start to see a real kind of growth in earth building in Ireland. And we do have this divide. So again, the culture thing is still there, that this corner, this southeast corner, they were used to these new cultures coming in, and they were kind of more accepting of change, whereas this northwest part of the country, it was kind of left alone. It was kind of the last bastion, I suppose, and that the change, the kind of vernacular change, was at a much slower pace. So another English gentleman came to Ireland in the late 1700s, Arthur Young, and he kind of gives us a bit of an insight as to what was going on at the time. So he was looking at the buildings, the type of construction he was finding around the country, and he was looking at, so we see already here we've got sod cabins, mud cabins, and stone and slate cabins, but he gave us prices, which was quite interesting. So back in those days, you could build a sod cabin for £2. Mm-hmm. You could build a mud cabin for £5 and 5 shillings, so you know, there's obviously a bit more technology going on here. And then you go for the stone and slate cabin, and you're talking the big books now, we're talking £15-16 to fill that. So you can see very clearly, already you're starting to get a kind of a cultural divide or a class system divide as to who was living where and why. And this is the kind of thing that he would have come across. So there's this great book, which was printed in the early 70s by Kevin Danaher. He's a folklorist and he traveled around Ireland and he photographed lots of buildings, and I'd say pretty much every building that he photographed doesn't exist anymore. So this is a sod house, and it's funny, I'll talk in a bit about how earth architecture is so invisible in Ireland, but you just have to scratch and people have memories. They just need that thing reignited. So my mother, who comes from Donegal from the northwest of Ireland, remembers the people living in the peat houses and the sod houses, and that they would have been the poorest of the poor, you know, and she would have grown up in a very small village where nobody in the village was particularly rich anyway, and they would have had pity for the people who were living in sod houses. And they could have been erected in a day, my mother remembers that, and a lot of it would have been the migrant workers, you know, people maybe travelling to follow the herring or to do the potato picking or to be cutting turf on the bogs. And then this sketch is courtesy of Arthur Young. This is the next kind of thing that was very prolific in Ireland, so the one-roomed cabin. So you talked about them already today, the byre dwellings where the family would live on one side and the animals lived on the other. And maybe as they got a bit of room or a bit more money, a bit more wealth, it may turn into a two-room cottage, and then the animals would be in one room and the humans would be in the other. But they weren't all little mud walled cabins. We do have beautiful mud houses all over the country as well. So the long house, and again, a form you get very typically in Scotland as well, the three-room cottage. This one is in County Leitrim. And then they could start to get quite grand. So this is a beautiful one, which is on the east coast of Ireland. I was called to survey it about a year ago, and it was handed down. It's in parts, it's 300 years old, somewhere between kind of 250, 300 years old. And it was one family lived in it until the 1980s. And the new owners who took over it, you know, were very kind of conscious of conserving it well. So it's always had a thatched roof in those 300 years. And it has this quite interesting render on the outside. It's very crumbly and very grey. We've actually given a bit to Tom that hopefully we'll kind of find out what is in it. We don't know if there's some kind of ash or something in it. But because of that, you know, it hasn't melted away. The walls are in incredible condition. And the only place where we have a bit of an issue is at the back of the house, kind of, back of the house, kind of in this area here. In this area here, there's actually a bathroom on the other side of that wall, a concrete bathroom, and there's lovely concrete, you know, kind of flashing details up onto the wall, and there is a big bit of the wall wearing away there. But other than that, the walls are nearly perfect. And the nice story about this too is it was the second son of a Catholic farmer. So a Catholic farmer to be rich in those days was pretty rare anyway. But because he was the second son, he wasn't going to inherit the money, but he had assets. He had corn mills on the land. And so it's kind of, you know, the thought, and again, not necessarily true, is that he wanted to build a grand house, but he could only afford peasant materials. But, you know, the more I look at this and the more people I talk to, people weren't stupid. They weren't building with these materials because they were poor and it was their only option. They were building with these materials out of choice because these materials were good. And then we start to get onto really grand houses. So this is a beautiful two-story one down in the southeast of the country, which actually next week I'm going to see because we need to repair this house. And the owner, Niall, got in touch with me because it's all cobble except for there's a big stone chimney in the middle. And the stone chimney, you know, there's problems with the stone chimney. And the contractor, they didn't know what the hell to do with it. The chimney has to come down. The cobwebs couldn't survive if the stone chimney comes down. So we'll just knock it all down. We'll construct it with a cavity block. And thankfully, he heard about us and he got in touch with us. And we can completely repair it. And I mean, if you look at the condition of the walls, you know, there's actually nothing wrong. There's a few corner cracks, like really typical problems. But you know, everyone on this project is kind of amazed that there's even a chance that this building can be salvaged. And you know, to me, there's very little wrong with that building, but this, you know, would be knocked under other circumstances. And then we have some really crazy little anomalies, well, maybe not, but we don't find them very often. So this is actually very close to me. And I'm driving down the road, we used to see this all the time, and we went and had a look. And someone earlier on was talking about there's a Clunabool. But it's this herringbone kind of pattern with the stone, and the building obviously is suffering because it's had a cement render on. It's just in the corner of a field with cattle, and the cattle rub against it all the time. And sadly, just in the last, literally about 3 weeks, this bit, the lintel has collapsed, so we're now down to here. But this looks like it would have been shuttered, you know, it was actually poured earth, you know, and that they kind of then packed in their herringbone stone. So earth building is really everywhere. And this is another lovely example from Kevin Danaher's book. This came from the north up in County Down. And again, because for our thatch, you know, we would often have quite rounded gables rather than the pointed gables, and just building it up with these, you know, it's probably sods again. And there's another example that somebody had sent to me where the building was originally a one-story building, and this is in County Armagh. And I haven't been to see this, but I really want to go and physically see this building, where it was, we don't call it cob in Ireland, just like Scotland, we call it mud wall, and where there was a mud wall base, and then they built up, just like you saw in some of the examples here, where they extended up to the apex of the roof using the turf. And again, images that are really similar to some of the images that we've seen this morning. So partition walls, particularly up in gables, again, building them with the wattle and daub. And then some lovely little examples too. So this was, there was something came up yesterday at the turf symposium, I think, where there was these kind of, you know, kind of small houses, but this wasn't a house, this was actually a forest worker, and it would be where he would leave his tools or just shelter out of the rain when the rain was particularly bad. So this was really kind of makeshift and just thrown up. I doubt any of these still exist in Ireland. And then there's a whole other kettle of fish when you start getting into the clay mortars, which, I mean, to be honest, I don't think there's a townland in Ireland that doesn't have some form of earth building represented when you start to take this into account. But it's been completely ignored and completely invisible for a long time. So we look at the 1841 census, we actually get some really interesting information from that. So 40% of the Irish population in 1841 lived in a one-room mud cabin. And this is the kind of thing that was written about them. The tottering, crumbling mud walls, the ragged, furrowed, and half-rotten patch, all together the erection is one which no unaccustomed eye can repose on without disgust and pity. So it wasn't great, like, you know, they were... they weren't all ideal, but we do actually have a beautiful example in this illustration of the wattle and daub wide chimney hood that we were talking about earlier. But it wasn't all grim, you know, like there was a lot of earth building around, and there were beautiful examples like this one, which was recently restored down in County Wexford as well. Archaeologists owned this building, so they kind of did a good job on it. And if we take all the earth building into account in Ireland in the 1841 census, so taking into account, you know, the farm, you know, the nice farmhouses as well, 50% of the Irish population lived in earthen buildings, okay? And that's not that long ago. But we've completely forgotten it in Ireland. It's just disappeared. And why is that? So anyone who's been to Dublin may have seen this. It's called the Famine Monument, and it's really harrowing. It's a really, really beautiful sculpture, and the man at the end is carrying his dying child on his shoulders, and it's really beautiful. And this is on Bertha Moor. This is the famine. So the famine took place between 1845 and 1852, and in that time, 1 million people died, and 1 million people emigrated. And I think because of that, we have a whole extra layer of negative association with earth wall that maybe doesn't exist in other countries. So this is a great newspaper article I found from 1878, The Irish Builder, and they're trying to figure out what to do with this kind of, you know, destitute, like, you know, this broken nation, these people who are still living in their, like, really grim one-room cabins. And when you read the paper, it's great. I mean, they're talking about just obliterating it completely, but they know they don't have enough materials yet to completely obliterate it, but they do talk about brick and concrete
already in 1878 and replacing our earth buildings with concrete. But they also know that, you know, we're going to have to build with earth for a while just because, you know, of the skills and the materials that are there. So there's even talk of a system from France of rammed earth that would make Roland very happy, where they describe the whole system of how you can unram a building and you know, build up to two-storey, and it's better quality than the stuff we've been building with. And they also have great suggestions for repairs, like you know, right-angled branches for doing corner repairs, because back then, just as now, it's the same areas that would fail. But after that, society seemed to just obliterate the memory, and you know, earth building just disappeared. It's there, but we don't know it's there at all in Ireland. So where are we now? So this is my happy family. Colin's not here today, he's spending time with the two little people outside her house. And recently there was a competition on the television, so RTÉ1, which is the Irish equivalent of BBC One, so big deal. We were asked to compete in a competition called Home of the Year. And personally for me, it was a great chance to put earth building and natural building on the map. So we jumped at it, we decided we'd take the chance. So we were up against a load of houses, 21 houses, and we got through to the final. And so this is our house up against, you know, other, you know, more conventional houses. And it was Home of the Year, so it's not about architectural fantasticness, it's more about a lot of what we're talking about, the feeling you get in the house, that hearth idea. And, you know, the judges knew they were going to visit a cob house. So we all know this house. And this is a still I took from the programme when she was describing her expectations of going to visit our house. I was expecting it to be dark and dingy. And all of us earth builders who try to convince people who have no experience of earth, all of us know this face. Okay. But anyway, she came and visited the house, and she saw that it's not dark and dingy, it's actually a very beautiful place to live, and it'll never look as tidy again. But she got over it, and she got a bit happier, and anyway, we came second, which was actually quite an amazing thing. Profile, okay, was amazing, but she never really got it, to be honest. But the two lads, Hugh and Declan, there, they talked a lot about the energy and the, you know, the connection they felt between the homeowner. They said it was powerful as they were walking around that house, and the love they could feel in those walls, and that's something I'll talk a little bit about later. So anyway, on the back of that, you know, I was kind of quite excited and buzzed, and kind of, you know, earth building was being a little bit talked about in Ireland. And I decided, Tom had asked me to talk about the culture of earth building in Ireland, so I decided what I'd do is that anybody who's ever contacted me in the last kind of, you know, 10 years, any connections I had to people who lived in earth buildings, I'd get in touch. So I sent out emails, I phoned people, I sent out letters, some lovely old Thatcher boys who just refused to use the computer. And I actually got, and what I wanted to keep it really free form. I didn't want to do a questionnaire. It was just kind of like ideas about earth building, you know, maybe how you got involved, what it means to you. And I wanted to keep it really free form. And amazingly, I got about 30 responses out of 60. I identified about 65 people. I got 30 responses. I checked my emails yesterday, and I've even got more coming in. So this is a project that's growing legs. This is going to turn into something much more than just this talk today. And there was a lot of themes that started to come up. And I also started to identify a lot of buildings around Ireland. So Roland will be very happy with this, and I've got all the coordinates on Google. So you can see they're everywhere. And this is just me personally, you know, all of these buildings, I've talked to people who live or are involved with these buildings. So I've identified 43 buildings, and that's just me. Now, we still have this divide, and it's written about in Ireland. There'll still be, you know, this, and you've just seen it on Tom's slide, this area is known for having mud wall, and this area is known for having mud wall. But really, most people will tell you there's no mud wall outside that, or there's no earth building outside that. Loch Ness, a little bit, would be known locally for mud wall, but not really, and not the rest of Ireland, nobody would really know. It makes sense, it's a big loch, there's lots of great building clay there, not much stone. But if we look at this, you know, what are all these buildings doing here? They're not supposed to be there. And then if we look at it again, what's going on in this area? You know, it's like this crazy earth building hotspot. Well, what's actually going on in that area is that's where I live. And I'm a witness. And when you open your eyes, it is everywhere. And so, you know, this one here, I only found out about last Sunday, the Sunday before I left Ireland, where I was down in a friend's house, and a real old fella from the mountain had come down to visit, and he was telling us about, there was a valley there where there used to be 13 putchin makers, like our Irish moonshine, and that they all built sod houses to have their putchin stills, and that there's still the remains of some of the sod houses there. So that's about 4 miles from my house, so when I go back, I'm going to check out my putchin still. Then, I need to hurry up, is that what you're saying? Okay, how much do I need to hurry up? I need to hurry up. Okay, so, right, so we'll pass on. But anyway, there's loads of really good stories there. So there's themes that came up from everybody: invisibility, negative associations, lack of skills and understanding, and bureaucracy. And what I mean there is, even though here there seems to be a lot of support for vernacular, it's kind of not that well supported in Ireland. And as one of the people said, she'd call it institutionalized evangelism, where, you know, in 25 years, she's seen 7 mud wall buildings in County Meath be demolished at the behest of the county council. They were told to demolish them because they weren't suitable. But there was also memories, positive energy, spirit of collaboration, community and family and sustainability. So, you know, I'll fly through these. Just this house burnt down in 2000. It was only when it burnt down that they realized it was mud wall. And then down the road, there was another one which they used to kind of inform them. And they had to, you know, figure out how to repair the hood, and you can see them doing it, and that was taken from that other house that was just discovered in 2005. Mud, mortars, you know, that's a big one. Negative associations, you all know these, okay? But in Ireland, we have that extra layer, so you have kind of all to wash away. But in Ireland, we also have poverty, despair, starvation, disease, and death. So that means the uphill battle, you know, when we're trying to get the message of earth building across, this really negative association. And then we look at our really awful, horrible, negative association buildings. Lack of skills and understanding, just knock it, it can't be repaired, too much trouble, substandard material, it won't last, you all know these. And then we look at these buildings from 1880, this is the client's great-great-granny sitting out in front of her building in 1880. Bureaucracy, when you get those two things together, negative associations, lack of understanding, and a suit, it can all go really wrong. And I often say you're free to replace the U with a H if you wish. So there was actually an active policy of demolish and rebuild in Ireland in the 80s and 90s. But for every negative thing, there's a positive thing. I'll just say maybe one more thing and then I'll leave it. I'll just show the side that I won't even talk. So the reason I put the yellow brick road there is there's a lot of memories of this in place names as well. So there's a place in Ireland called Enfield, but the Irish for it is on Bohabui, which is the yellow road. And we think it's probably because the clay there is the yellow clay. So there's a lot of, it's there, like I say, you only have to scratch beneath the surface. Anyway, people sent me wonderful stories and wonderful photos, so I'll just show you some of the beautiful things that people showed or sent me. So this is what's going on in Ireland now. And that's who it's all about at the end of the day, dear my little munchkins. So that's it. And I just have to finish. I share a surname with William Butler Yeats, Sligo poet. I live in his county, and it's his 150th birthday tomorrow. So just a quote from him, tread softly because you tread in my dreams, because that was a big thing everyone talked about, is that feeling in the walls, you feel it in your film. Thank you.